Better get your dustpan and brush.
Yes, Mr. Bucket.
And tell his lordship.
Yes, Mr. Bucket.
Wait a minute. What's all this? Must have come out of the wall. Manuscript.
Gives you the creeps. Sort of place to see ghosts.
Don't talk such rubbish, girl. Ghosts.
Ma.
Way to drive.
The man's a public danger.
My husband's getting his name. He's going to report him to the company.
And quite right, too.
He's a refugee. French.
Well, there you are.
Come on. Shouldn't be allowed over here.
He says when he drives, it reminds him of Paris.
So it does me. It really is most annoying. Again, Mr. Haywood, no chance to see the country.
What? Paris, Mr. Haywood.
Hmm? Haywood?
Hello.
We're there.
Oh.
Good heavens, can you sleep in this thing?
After tanks, I can sleep in anything.
We thought we'd lost you, Mr. Haywood.
Shorndwit.
Condit.
What?
It's pronounced Condit. Come along. It's just a page of English history. Of course, being so cut off, things change very slowly here. Naturally, there's been a good deal of, intermarriage.
The foreigner?
Yes. Just think. Generation after generation of them baptized and buried here.
And spending most of their time in between over at the Chaundwit Arms.
Condit.
Oh, yes.
Tomb of her. 1564.
Really? Arthur Bucket.
Wrong again.
Well, that's what it says there.
Yes, yes, yes. The village pronounce it Bucket. The family call it Bouquet.
Oh, I see.
A little gem, don't you think?
Yes. That stained glass is absolutely
modern.
We really ought to hurry. We shall miss the guide.
Whatever happens, don't let Mr.
Guy. In places like this, one is frequently shown a room in which Queen Elizabeth is said to have spent the night. And I need hardly tell you that these claims would be very difficult to prove. But with regard to the room in which you are now standing, ancient documents have proved conclusively that this room is one of the very few in which Queen Elizabeth never spent the night. Now, if you'll pass through that door and look out of the window on your left, you'll see an oak tree in which King Charles may well have hidden after the Battle of Worcester.
Say, how do you get to be a lord, anyway?
Well, either you sell so much of something that you put the other guys out of business, or you get yourself the right kind of father.
When are we going to see the ghost, Mom?
quiet.
That was a constable. And that a Gainsborough. And that was a very beautiful portrait by Sir Joshua Reynolds.
Wonderful collection.
So varied.
Yes.
When are we going to see the ghost, Mum?
If you don't be quiet, I won't show you no ghost.
After the bombing, we found this old chest. It had evidently been walled up several hundreds of years ago.
Was anything found in it?
Yes, it was full of old manuscripts.
And is this where the ghost was seen?
Oh, no. That was in there, if you'll pass along.
Oh, Mom!
Quiet!
Lovely view.
Yes, sir.
Perhaps you can tell me, who is this?
We make it a rule, sir, never to discuss the family with visitors.
No, of course not.
The portrait is of Lady Mary, sir, his lordship's only daughter. At present, she is at the Agricultural College at Killingham.
I see. Thank you.
Not at all, sir.
Oh. Those old manuscripts that were discovered.
Yes, sir?
I'm very interested. I wonder if I might be allowed to examine them.
It's very hard to say so.
Yes, I was afraid it would be.
On second thought, sir, I'm sure his lordship would be only too pleased. Are you staying in the locality, sir?
No. Yes, I am.
Then I'll tell his lordship you'll be calling, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. There's nothing else I can do for you, sir?
No, not until I've been to the bank.
Yes, sir.
I want to see Lord Condit. Mr. and Mrs. Pike at the Dower House.
I'm afraid his lordship is engaged at the moment, sir.
We'll wait.
Yes.
Well, what is it? If you ring that bell again, I'll wring your neck.
This way, sir.
That's no way for uncle and nephew to be speaking.
So that youngster's your nephew, eh?
No, she's my uncle. This way, sir.
Thank you.
Now, who would be likely to send a telegram?
I should say only a creditor, my lord.
I suppose so. Oh, well, we'll let it mature. And that will be all for today, ladies and gentlemen. If you'll kindly pass out by that door.
There's a Mr. and Mrs. Pike waiting in the library.
Pike? Pike. Now, where have I heard that name before?
The gentleman to whom you let the Dower House, my lord.
Oh, yes. We always wondered which end would fall in first. Now we shall probably hear.
Yes, my lord.
I don't seem to have any, What do you want?
The guide.
Oh, that's all right. I'll take care of him. I should like to,
Thank you, no. Oh. There is a little table by the door.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, look.
I'm not going to give him anything. He didn't show us no ghost.
Oh, we're going to see a ghost, Mum!
Oh, quiet!
£1.37
How the old place does echo.
Yes, my lord. There was a gentleman in the party this afternoon, my lord, who wanted to see the old manuscripts.
Do you think he might buy them?
I couldn't say, my lord.
Well, did he appear to be a man of substance?
Of moderate substance, I should say, my lord.
Oh, where is he? Show him in.
He's gone, my lord.
Gone? You let someone go who might buy you something.
He'll be calling, my lord. I understand he's staying in the locality.
We must invite him to lunch. When there is any lunch. Well, our fortunes seem to be on the turn, Bucket. If we go on like this, we'll soon be paying wages again.
A refreshing prospect, my lord. Shall I show in Mr. and Mrs. Pike?
Very well. Oh, Bucket, my brother is coming.
And your lordship's sister-in-law?
No, I'm afraid so. Are there any guest rooms that still have ceilings?
Only in the old wing, my lord.
Well, I suppose you can get it ready.
Yes, my lord. It'll mean turning the owls out of the baths.
That's a pity. Oh, I doubt if they'd care to stay.
No, my lord.
Seems old Harry's got his boy coming home.
Which one?
Why, George. He was went out east, long in the army.
Where'd you get that from?
I got it from old Alf. He had it from old Tom. When he went up the farm, see old Lou.
I shall never get you, Bucket, straight. Are Tom and Lou your cousins or what?
Why, certainly not. Old Tom's my aunt's half-brother's niece's boy.
Well, what about Lou? Who's he?
Tiny. It's a she. She's married to old Dick.
Last week he was caught red-handed taking her hair. And now there's some ridiculous legal quibble. And my lawyers say I can't prosecute because the animal was started on your side of the boundary.
It sounds rather like splitting hairs, doesn't it?
This is no laughing matter. I've done the best I can. You've got to prosecute, my lord. Coming from you, it may have some effect.
Yes. Now, before you took that land, they'd always been used to going up there. The rabbits must be kept down, you know.
It isn't a question of rabbits. This was a hare, and that's game.
Harry's got a lot of mouths to feed, Mr. Pike.
I'm sure he can do with the extra meat.
That's what I keep telling him.
You keep out of this. Pike says he's going to stamp out poaching. He says Harry's the ringleader. Property must be protected, my lord. We landowners must stick together. If we don't, the whole country will go to pot.
I must say, sometimes I rather envy Harry. It must be fun to do a little poaching, don't you think?
No, I don't. I'm a law-abiding man.
Ah, yes, the law. Have you ever noticed the faces of the judges, Mr. Pike? Take my advice and leave the law alone. It saddens a man.
My lord, I'm a busy man. I've no time to listen to all this.
You know, Mr. Pike, the trouble with you and me is that we've never had enough time to enjoy ourselves. I've always been too busy on committees and things, and you've always been too busy being successful. We've never had time to notice the sweet peas.
Sweet peas? What sweet peas?
Any sweet peas. Crimson Glory, for preference. They're rather nice, don't you think?
I just adore sweet peas.
I'm so glad. Have some more toast.
Oh.
Do I take it then that you refuse to prosecute?
Well, I've known Harry for a very long time, and I like to think of his children having a rabbit.
But I keep on saying it wasn't a rabbit. It was a hare.
Well, that can be very nice, too, with a little red currant jelly.
Well, I tell you, they won't get away with it. If they want to fight, they can have it. And before I've done with them, Harry Bucket will wish.
Well, Charles, here we are.
Why, Harriet, how nice of you to come and cheer us up again. This is quite a surprise.
But didn't you get my telegram?
Telegram? Oh, yes. My lord, we're going.
Oh, must you? Well, look, this way is easier. You can go through the garden. Goodbye, Mrs. Pike. You must come and see us again.
Pike, not the Leicestershire Pikes.
No, ma'am. The football pool Pikes.
Curious people. Now, Charles. What's all this about having no tenant's ball for Mary's coming-of-age celebrations?
My dear Harriet, for a tenant's ball, one needs two things, money and tenants. We've none of one, and very few of the other.
Of course there'll be a ball. No bouquet ever came of age for that one.
No bouquet ever came of age in the middle of a world war.
That is not our fault.
I wonder.
Arthur. That disgraceful business with that village boy, what's his name, George Bucket. You don't think there's any danger of...
Oh, they were only children. Besides, he's in the army now.
You say that as if the army were a monastery. From what I hear, it's not at all the same thing.
The telephone.
Yes. I paid your account. I was tired of never being able to ring you.
We haven't heard that since Easter 41.
No, it was the year the Germans went into Norway.
No, it weren't. It was the year I put the new handle in my old broom.
Well, aren't you going to answer it?
Yeah. Where was it? Oh, yes, I remember. Do him good to have a run.
Hello? Who? One moment, please. Yes? Oh, yes, milady. Tonight, I'll tell his lordship. Only your aunt, milady. Quite, milady. Goodbye, milady.
Miles from where you live.
It's not more than a couple of hundred yards.
Well, don't you think you need the exercise? The whole place is like a cold storage vault.
And it's usually warmer in the garden.
I have no intention of spending the night in the garden. Arthur, tell Bucket I'll have a bath.
Yes, dear.
Come along, come along.
Yes, dear.
Phew.
I did suggest she should use my brother's bathroom, but she said she didn't like putting people out.
Hey?
She said she didn't like putting people out.
Ah.
You know, sir, there are five ways of stoking that stove. None of them any use.
What have you been doing? Isn't it hot yet?
It ought to be. I know I am.
It's like having a bath in Salisbury Cathedral. Well, the steam's very nice, but where's the water?
See if you can move that thing any further, Bucket.
This is ridiculous. I shall use your brother's bathroom. Bucket, you look very dirty.
Dear Pai Talk, you think he bought the place? Seems you can't have a rabbit now without you pay for it. And you go with your cap in your hand.
But were you on Pike's land?
No, sir. I hadn't so much as set foot on his land. I was standing on his lordship's side of the boundary when up rushes old Bird. Well, he hollers out at me. What's up, I says. You're poaching, he says, that's what. Don't talk so daft, I says.
What did he say?
I'm working for Pike, he says. I'm gamekeeper here. Well, I says, some folks will do anything for money.
My best respects, sir.
Best respects, sir.
Hello, Ruby. I suppose you want to get in the old barn again.
Yes, Grandfather.
I reckon we better find you the key then, eh?
Yes, Grandfather.
Here you are. He can't unlock it.
Why can't he?
I ain't give him the right key. For 2 years now, he's been coming for that key, and I ain't give him the right one yet.
Old Tom says Pike's as wild as a wet hen.
He can't do nothing.
Oh, can't he just? Tom says he's going to ask the bench to make an order for your little old dog to be destroyed.
Destroyed? What do you say, sir? They can't do that, can they?
Well, I think legally the only thing they can make an order for would be sheep worrying.
Ah, he don't pay no attention to sheep. All he cares about is rabbits. Besides, Pike ain't got no sheep.
Oh, yes, he have. He had two little old tigs put in there day before yesterday. I seen them.
What did I say? He's laying for Yari.
I tell you, my little old dog wouldn't know a sheep if he sees one. Wouldn't look at him.
Morning, Daddy.
Good morning, my dear.
Morning, Uncle Arthur.
Morning, Mary.
Morning, Aunt Harriet.
Everything's cold.
Oh, I had mine hours ago. I've been over to Cooper's about my job. I'm starting a fortnight.
I hope you realize you'll have to help me with the arrangements for the ball.
Yes, as long as it's understood that I don't approve. You know my views on that sort of thing.
I've heard them, but I don't understand them.
Well, it's just that it's obsolete. Sole purpose is to reduce tenants to a proper state of humility.
I never had anything so preposterous. You talk like a socialist.
I am a socialist, Auntie.
That sort of thing comes from not having a mother.
I must say you look very good, my dear.
I'm feeling very good. George is coming home.
George? George who?
Why, George Bucket, of course.
And what, may I ask, is it to you if one of the village boys is coming home?
Why, Auntie, you know that George and I... Were...
I know nothing of the sort. An association between anyone in your position and some village moron is not only unnatural, it's outrageous. And if your father had any sense of responsibility, he'd do something about it.
I object to you talking like that about my fiancé. Besides, he's not a moron. He's a corporal.
One has certain responsibilities, Mary. When you were 15, there may have been some excuse. At 21, there is none. As a member of a titled family...
Oh, nuts.
I beg your pardon.
All right, only don't let it happen again.
This is intolerable. Charles, you sit there stuffing yourself with toast while your child insults me.
Oh, Harriet, I don't think Mary really meant to...
Oh, yes, I did. You don't have to make excuses for me, Daddy. We've had all this over and over again until I'm sick and tired of it. Just because hundreds of years ago somebody knocked somebody else off a horse, George Bucket isn't good enough to speak to us. But he's good enough to fight for us. And when he comes back, if he still wants me to, I intend to marry him. And no one's going to stop me.
I think she really means it.
There was a time when age used to entitle one to a little respect.
Yes. I think the young people are beginning to see through that one. Miss Will, if you'll excuse me, I'm a little late. I have a meeting.
Arthur.
Yes, dear?
You wouldn't say I was being unreasonable, would you?
No, dear, not at all, dear.
You'd better not.
Lady Mary.
Yes, I know. Who are you?
Oh, my name's Haywood. I rang up. Your father asked me to lunch.
Oh, he must have forgotten. He's gone out today. You'll have to put up with me instead.
That's exactly what... That'll be charming.
I shan't have very much time, as I've got to entertain some dreary old professor who's coming to look at some manuscripts.
I'm afraid that's me.
You a professor?
Well, when I say I'm a professor, I don't mean I'm a professor.
But then you haven't.
Oh, yes, I have. That's why I've come.
Yes. I'll have the manuscripts brought down for you.
Oh, but your father said that you'd show me round.
Round what?
Oh, just round. Let's start with the garden, shall we?
Bucket. Who's that young man in the garden?
That's the professor, ma'am. He's working on the old manuscripts.
At the moment, he seems to be working on my niece. He looks very virile for a professor.
I find him a very pleasant young gentleman, ma'am.
Oh, you do, do you?
Tell me something.
Hmm?
Did you really come here to look at old manuscripts?
Of course. Why?
I just wondered. Oh, dear, life is difficult, isn't it?
That's what it's for.
I suppose so. All the week you've been such fun, and today somehow you're different. You're cross, aren't you?
Not in the least.
Yes, you are. You're cross because by all the rules I ought by now to be in your arms.
I never heard such a scandalous suggestion. Since we're answering questions, have you spent your time with me solely to try and sell the manuscript?
It means an awful lot to Daddy.
Well, in that case, if I don't buy them, I'll make it my life's work to see that somebody does.
That's charming of you.
Charm's one of my few assets. The other is persistence.
Peter, I think I should tell you, I have to go away tomorrow morning.
Tomorrow? When did you know?
About half a minute ago.
Evening, George.
Good evening, sir.
20 players, please.
Yes, sir.
Looks like a full house tonight.
Always is on bench days, sir. There's Mr. Haywood.
Hello, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Hello, Harry. How'd you get on in court today?
All right, sir.
I say he did, too. Old Pike weren't half mad.
Them tips you give me worked a treat.
Good. What happened?
Well, the court wouldn't make no order. Just said to keep the dog under control, like. Pike.
Hi. What about that stuff I ordered?
I've had no one to send, sir. It'll be up next week.
Next week?
I knows anything about Pike, he won't sit down under it. You mark my words, the man with the money always wins.
At any rate, Harry seems to have won the first round, and that certainly calls for a celebration. What's this rough you all drink?
Cider, sir.
Why don't you try it, sir? George, canner up for the gentleman.
Coming up.
You don't seem so bright as usual, sir. Feeling out of sorts?
I think I probably got a bit cold after bathing.
Bathing? It's a bit early in the year for that, ain't it?
Well, it's been so warm.
Ah, that's where it finds you out.
After August bank holiday, I never had a bath till it's 4 years on the barley.
Yeah, sir.
Thanks.
You get a few quarts of that inside you. You'll be all right.
When are you going to do some work, then, Loopy?
Ain't going to do no work while Granver's alive.
One of the old man.
Yeah, you heard what's happened.
What's that?
Why, about Pike.
What about him?
Well, you know the ploughing.
Oh, come on, what's he done?
Seems he's told them to plough up the cricket pitch.
Plough it up?
You say it as if he'd done a murder.
Murder, sir, I could understand. But a man what ploughs up a cricket pitch.
I like it because you can keep on drinking it. It doesn't have slightest effect. Mind remains clear as crystal. Brain works with the precision of a... What are we talking about?
You were saying as Pike owns the land, he's got the law on his side. And there's nothing we can do.
Nothing we can do.
Something's got to be done.
What?
About that land. It used to be a common, and I had it fenced in. It belongs to them. It's been on my conscience for 400 years.
As long as that?
Yes, and what they want is a lawyer. Why don't you take up the case? Be good practice for you.
Yes. Yes, it would. Well, thanks, old boy. Something's got to be done.
But a minute ago, you said there was nothing we could do.
Of course there is. It's been on my conscience for 400 years.
Well, the boys are feeling a bit down about it. Perhaps you'd say a word to them, eh?
Certainly I'll say a word. I'll say several. Be good practice.
Now, quiet, please. Mr. Hayward's going to say a word to you.
Gentlemen, I rise to say a few words on this momentous occasion. Although only a comparative stranger to the district, I don't feel a stranger. Look on you all as my friend. Feel I've known me all your lives. And 400 years, a heck of a long time.
Aye?
Gentlemen, if this fellow Pike thinks he can interfere with us with impurity, he's mistaken. Certainly one answer to that sort of thing, and that is action. We won't take this lying down. Teach him a lesson he won't forget. Hey! But we must have time.
Time, gentlemen.
Thank you. Where was I?
You was just going to teach him a lesson.
Was I?
Ah.
What this man has done is repugnant to every right-thinking man, woman, child, and bird. From every side, yea, from the four corners of Condit, will come the avenging hordes. This fellow Pike will find himself hoist with his own. He'll get what's coming to him. We'll put my plan into action immediately. That is, directly I've had a chance to think of one. And before we finished with Mr. Pike, he's going to wish he'd never set foot in this earthly paradise. This sceptred, the emerald... Gentlemen, I raise my glass, tankard, to Condit, Old Harry, and St. George! Yay!
Yes, sir, she went away early this morning. You'll be working here as usual today, sir?
I suppose so. Bucket, did you ever try that stuff they call rough?
An occasional glass, sir.
Is it true they put rats in it?
Well, sir, they do say that a dead rat gives the flavor a certain...
They're right, it does.
Perhaps a cup of strong coffee would enable you to work, sir.
I doubt it, but we might try.
Very good, sir. Yes, my lady, he's in the library.
Mary!
Have you been here all the time I've been away?
Well, I thought if I went away, it might be difficult to find an excuse to come back.
Peter, before I left, I tried to make it clear that...
I know, but I've discovered I'm very thick-skinned. I must be. I've spent 10 days in this room and I'm still alive. Oh, you'll need this.
No, I'm used to it. I'm afraid you've suffered in vain.
Well, not quite. I've seen you again, and I've got an invitation for the ball tomorrow night, and... Well, there's something I want to tell you.
First, I'd like to tell you something. I came back this morning because my fiancé's coming home.
You're... Well, congratulations.
After I left, I realized I ought to have explained. His name's George Bucket. He's Harry's son.
Oh! You certainly kidded me that...
I'm not kidding. Why shouldn't he be Harry's son?
Well, no reason at all, I suppose. Do the family approve?
No. Aunt Harriet's been trying to break it up for years. When she first found out about it, she sent me abroad to school. Then when I came back, he'd just gone in the army.
You mean you haven't seen each other since you were children?
Only once. The night before he went overseas. It was a fearful row about that, too. But they couldn't stop us writing. And now he's coming back, so... You see.
Yes, I see.
You don't think a title makes any difference, do you?
Well, we all look the same in our underpants.
Yes. But we don't go about in them.
No, sometimes I think it's rather a pity. Think how it would brighten up the House of Commons. You don't think that after all this time... He may not be quite what you imagine.
If I'm sure of anything, I'm sure of George.
Well, thank you for telling me. When one does make a mistake, it's something to make it on the grand scale. I guess I may as well go for the midday train.
But you'll stay for the ball.
I don't think I will, if you don't mind. Oh, by the way, I've got a friend at the British Museum to look at those manuscripts, and he rang me up this morning, so I may have something to tell you.
It's good of you to bother.
Not a bit. I'll write to your father. You might say goodbye for me.
Yes.
I hope George Bucket comes up to scratch.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Don't let Pike get away with anything.
Don't you be afraid, sir. We won't.
Oh, it's you.
Yes, it's me. And I've had just about enough of you, young man. I know who's been stirring things up.
I'm sorry, Mr. Pike. I'm just trying to catch a train.
Good. Get out and stay out.
Well, thanks for coming to see me off.
I beg your pardon.
Don't they have any other drivers on this route?
Did you say drivers?
Sir, going away then?
Yes.
Got your ticket?
I've got a return.
Heard about Harry, I suppose.
No, what?
You remember that night old Harry was saying, well, that's about finished, old man Pike, and I says to him, don't you speak too soon.
Yes.
And I told him the man with the money always wins, didn't I?
Well?
Well, he has won.
Who has?
Why, Pike. He's gone and bought the land where Harry's got his brickfield, and he'll give old Harry notice to quit. Reckon it'll about finish him.
But he can't do that. That's just sheer vindictiveness because we won over the cricket field.
That's just it. Matter of fact, some of them saying it's all your fault.
My fault? Well, how'd you make that out?
Well, it's on account of your making Pike's a figuring mad front of the committee.
Well, that's what they wanted, isn't it? They were pleased enough at the time.
Well, it's on account of your being a foreigner, as you might say. You see, in Condit, we looks twice at foreigners.
Well, of all the ungrateful, narrow-minded sons of...
Ah, there she is.
That's terrible about Harry. What's he going to do?
Well, he can't do nothing. Reckon he's about done for.
But he's got a whole lot of kids, hasn't he?
Oh, I wouldn't say a lot. About 7 or 8.
Tell him I'll write. Seven kids, my God.
So young, too.
Something called the clutterbug.
Really?
Jitter, sir, jitter.
I beg your pardon?
You know that fellow?
Never clapped eyes on him in my life.
Damned impertinence.
Shall we try it?
Yes, 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 rather.
I like to see them enjoying themselves.
What they calls the cakewalk.
I don't know with these newfangled dances. Perhaps if
be safer if we carried on with the barn dance. 1, 2, 3, kick.
Miss Bucket, you dance like an autumn leaf.
Oh, your lordship. Thank you.
Arthur, when Harriet's not looking, some port in the library.
Goodbye. Thank you. Very nice.
Here, what'd I tell you now? Go on. Give the olders a chance. Oh, here's something I haven't tried before.
Good evening, Bert.
Good evening,
milady. Just a minute, Harry. Where's George?
I couldn't rightly say, milady.
Isn't he coming?
Oh, I expect he'll be along presently.
Oh. I'm awfully sorry about the brick field. Pity Mr. Hayward's gone. He might have been able to help you.
I've got a telegram from him.
From Mr. Hayward?
I've got it here somewhere. Can't make it out, milady. Seems to me Pike's already won. To tell the truth, I come here tonight intending to give him a piece of my mind.
He seems to have had the good taste not to come.
Oh, but his missus have, though. That's her over there.
She looks very unhappy. I'd better go over and talk to her. Perhaps she has some influence with her husband.
Waste of time, milady. The only influence he'd understand is a brick on the back of his head.
There's no harm in trying.
I like a good tune. Something you can get hold of. Like that thing, you know. The one that Viola Raine used to sing at the Alhambra. Before it was pulled down, of course. Must have been during the last war. Or the last but one.
I said, Dad, you like the frock? Of course, I should have had my hair done differently, but my maid wanted to go out with her young man this evening. And what can you do? They're so independent these days. You're just back from the East, and naturally.
Right.
I say, can you play that thing, you know, it goes like this. La da di da 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 ta da.
Of course, boys, if you were the only girl in the world.
Tell one tune from another.
I can't. These fellows can't even play a simple melody.
Of course, I don't want to lose her. Good maids are so hard to find now, aren't they? But I know the next thing will be she'll want to marry this George of hers, and then of course...
George?
That's her young man's name. Are
you sure it was George?
Oh, yes. It's been going on for ages. He's the son of that man, Harry Bucket, the one my husband had so much trouble with. You probably know him.
Yes, I think I do.
I always said we should have trouble living in the country, but my...
Is everything all right, dear?
Everything's perfect.
Well, that's the last of them. Laid down by our grandfather in the year of the mutiny. I will just have one, and then we'll go and do our stuff.
I ought to get back to the ballroom, or Harriet will be annoyed.
You'll never see another bottle like that. See Harriet every day.
Yes, that's just it. I think I'd better just go and see what's happening. Then I might come back.
Oh, better be quick. Thank you.
Looks very nice.
I thought you'd think better of it, Arthur.
Is it good for rheumatism?
Oh, if it's rheumatism you want, you couldn't have anything better.
It isn't Malmsey, is it?
Tastes all right to me. Say, Arthur, you're looking pale.
Yes, I know. It's the night work. I feel completely washed out. What century is it?
Oh, about 11.
I just thought it was later than that.
You know, Arthur, I never realized what a strange likeness that is on that old tomb in the church.
I must have a look at that. Have they given me a good position?
You look pretty comfortable with your feet on a spaniel. Harriet isn't nearly so good. Come to think of it, why is she there at all?
I thought she ought to be it. I'd put the other five in the river.
Five? Arthur, I'd no idea.
They talk too much. I'm a man who likes peace and quiet. Though they did call me the terror of Condit.
I never believed it.
Then why am I a major character in history?
My dear fellow, you could never get away with anything. You're absolutely transparent. Listen. Music. This port is even better than I thought.
You know, between ourselves, I was the one who enclosed that common. It's worried me a lot. When you've been walled up for a few hundred years, it's curious how a little thing like that gets on your nerves. I have approached one or two people about it, but they either scream and run away or look right through me. Nobody ever saw through me when I was alive, and I can't say I like it. In fact, from what I've seen of the present, I don't think much of it. Can't even get a drink. But before I go back, I must get that land off my conscience. There isn't much time. They're rebuilding my wall. They've nearly finished it. Nobody ever listens to me.
Yes. When you've taken those in, go back and get the sausage rolls.
Yes, Mr. Byers.
I always had that effect on women.
Peter, what are you doing here?
Oh, I just came down because I wanted to see Harry.
Oh.
What's the trouble?
There isn't any trouble. I just thought I'd rest a minute, that's all.
Oh, that's fine. Have you seen George?
Yes.
Do you still feel the same way about him?
Does it matter?
Not to me. I just thought it might to you. As a matter of fact, I've been thinking quite a lot about you and George.
Very nice of you.
Yes. I said to myself, now supposing when she met him again after all that time, he turned out to be a bit of a disappointment. Would she, I asked myself, remembering, of course, that she's a bit stubborn, and that her aunt would be the first to say, I told you so, would she, I asked myself, be likely to admit that she'd made a mistake?
Well, since I seem to be eavesdropping, what answer did you get from yourself?
Well, I confess that I had to admit that she'd gone pretending that she was still in love with George and that he'd come up to expectations, but that she'd probably used the title as an excuse to explain away...
Perhaps you'd both like to come downstairs.
Am I boring you?
You flatter yourself, Mr. Hayward.
There's that fella again.
Who?
The fella who said flutter or something. Damned impertinence.
Well, if you'll excuse me now, I'll...
Aren't we going to dance?
I'm sorry, but I'm in rather a hurry. I've got an awful lot to do.
What do you mean?
I can't explain now. I'll tell you all about it in the morning. Goodbye. Well, what did they say?
Well, the boys will do anything to get one back on Pike.
But are you sure it'll be all right?
If you want to win a battle, you've got to take risks. Now get them all together and bring them out to the stable. George, you come with me.
We hope he knows what he's doing.
Bucket, tell the band to play Auld Lang Syne, and perhaps they'll realize there's nothing more to eat.
You're quite, ma'am.
Where do you want this locked up? Front lawn.
I do hope you know what you're doing.
Don't you worry about that. You go and take care of that lock.
Police. Emergency call.
Back at the Dower House, please. Hundreds of animals are all over my garden.
Where?
The Dower House. The whole place is alive with animals.
You don't want the police. You want the sanitary inspector.
I want the police, I tell you. Send every man you've got.
Information has been laid this day by Joseph Pike of the Dower House Condit for that you, on the 5th day of April 1944 at Condit, within the district aforesaid, with certain domestic animals, did unlawfully and maliciously destroy certain trees, flowering plants, fruits, and vegetables, being the property of one Joseph Pike, then and there growing in a certain garden in the occupation of the said Joseph Pike, there situate, thereby doing injury to the said Joseph Pike to the sum of £117, 4 shillings, and 1 halfpenny, contrary to Section 23 of the Malicious Damage Act, 1861. Peter Haywood, do you plead guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty, sir.
It's a little difficult, my lord. As usual in this court, all the defendants have the same surname. There are 3 Georges, 2 Berts, a Harry, a Tom, and an Ebenezer.
Perhaps I can help, sir. I represent all my co-defendants, and they plead not guilty.
Oh, thank you, Mr.
Haywood.
Oh, yes, yes. The defendants may sit down. Prosecution, my lord, is represented by Sir Henry Wade,
And Mr. Patterson.
Sir Henry Wade.
Sir Henry, are you ready to...
No.
Oh, quite.
Lummy, they brought some law with them.
Looks like we brought some too.
May it please your worship.
Before Sir Henry opens the case for the prosecution, I should like to raise a point of law.
By all means, Mr.
The Dower House Gardens, sir, mentioned in the charge, are part of land which at one time was a common. I don't think this will be disputed, as the adjoining land is still known as the Old Common. And from time immemorial, the people of Condit have had the right to graze their animals on it. Now, I maintain that they have never lost this right, and that this court has therefore no jurisdiction to deal with the case at all.
Papa, shut up.
Well, Sir Henry, do you...
Yes, I do. The point is, of course, purely frivolous and hardly calls for any answer, but I will dispose of it at once by referring my very young and doubtless very learned friend to the well-known case of Tar Barrel versus Tar Barrel.
May we have the reference?
I should have thought any lawyer would have known it. But I have the actual report here. It was decided in the reign of Queen Victoria.
But while Sir Henry is searching, perhaps I might refer to the equally well-known case of Sprocket versus the Abbot of Bude, the Archbishop of Canterbury intervening, which was decided in the reign of Charles II.
We'll have your reference, too, if you don't mind.
Yes. Yes, of course.
Hand it off. No, that's not it. Try the law times. Here, give me Arch. Get himself proper tied up, they will.
There seems little point, my lord, in pursuing the common law back through the ages. These leading cases are frequently contradictory, and I prefer to base my argument on statute law. In particular, I rely on 3 Elizabeth.
In that case, I rely on 7 John.
The devil's he talking about?
Going to phone.
Why do they keep on going back?
That's the law. It's a question of which can go back farthest.
What on earth is all this? Do you know these references?
Of course, my lord, I'm familiar with them, but I should just like to refresh my memory.
That's right, Mr. Roberts. Yes, yes, I will, Mr. Roberts. Thank you, Mr. Roberts. Well, do you know who that was?
Was it Mr. Roberts?
Yes, he's giving me the front page.
Why, Mr. Tripp, you'll soon be getting into the London papers.
Well, I'm not exactly in Fleet Street yet, but I've got one foot in the door.
Is his lordship in court?
Yes. Well, I must run.
Officer?
Yes, ma'am?
How far have they got?
When I came out, ma'am, they just got back to Ethelred the Unready.
I don't know what the man's talking about.
There's no room.
There's plenty of room. Would you kindly move along, please? Thank you.
We've gone some distance into the past, Sir Henry. Can you give us some indication of how much further we're likely to be going before lunch?
That, my lord, would appear to depend upon my young but excessively learned friend.
Lord, I think I can shorten the proceedings. When Condit Court was bombed, as your lordship knows, certain ancient manuscripts were discovered. Among them was this, on which I shall call expert evidence. It is an affidavit sworn on his deathbed by the father of the third Earl. That is, the one who, under a royal license, enclosed the land now occupied by Mr. Pike.
Which, of course, he had every right to do.
If he was, in fact, the Earl. But I propose to prove that this Arthur Bucket, or Bouquet, was not Lord Condit at all. And that with all due respect to those present, none of the family have had any right to the title or the land for the last 400 years.
Silence! As the point now raised seems to affect me personally and somewhat considerably, perhaps it would be better if I retired during the hearing of this case.
No. No possible objection.
Of course you must stay. We couldn't hear it.
I entreat your lordship to do no such thing.
As far as we are concerned, we are more than content with the court as constituted.
What did he want to do that for?
Oh, a pretty wise move.
All agreed? Very well.
I'll call my witnesses straight away, my lord. If they succeed in convincing you, it'll save Sir Henry the trouble of opening the case at all.
If they succeed.
Dr. Rose, just go in the box for me, please.
Who's he, then?
I don't know.
Will you take the book in your right hand and read the oath?
I swear by Almighty God, the evidence I shall give shall be...
Mr. Hayward, say where he was wounded. Charles
James Rose. Book, I think.
That wasn't what I meant.
Now, Doctor.
Excuse me. There seems to be some dispute as to the pronunciation of the names Bucket or Bouquet. It may assist the court to know that both are wrong. In the 16th century, it was always pronounced Buki.
Buki.
I've never heard such nonsense.
I must ask members of the public to keep quiet.
He called me a member of the public.
He's short-sighted.
I should perhaps add that earlier still, it was pronounced Buket.
Thank you, Doctor. That's most helpful. Now we don't know where we are.
I think we have enough to go on with. Continue, Mr.
Doctor, you are chief custodian of medieval manuscripts at the British Museum.
I am.
You have examined this affidavit. Is it, in your opinion, a genuine document of the date it bears?
I should say it is undoubtedly genuine.
Briefly, it is a confession by the father of the so-called third Earl of Condit, recounting how he exchanged his son for the rightful Earl when they were infants.
Upon my soul, surely we're not going to be treated to that old chestnut. Why, it's the oldest, fairest story in the world.
That's just the point. It was the fairy story gave him the idea. Dr. Rose, perhaps you would read paragraph 9.
Then did I remember how I did read in an ancient fable that certain infants were exchanged in cunning fashion, and to the damnation of my soul I did thereupon effect the like exchange between mine own son and the infant Lord Condit, who was forthwith placed with a nursewoman of the village, sworn to keep silence on pain of death, albeit she was well recompensed for her services. And thenceforth, the little... Thus did sit...
I didn't quite...
Did sit in his place and merrily did flourish withal.
Your worships, this is just an attempt to fog the issue. This case now threatens to involve a revolution in the peerage that would require a special act of Parliament to put matters right.
I agree, sir.
All this is very unfortunate, Mr. Hayward, and must be very painful for his lordship's family.
With all due respect, sir, they've been very lucky. The truth is that they're descended from one of the biggest thugs in history.
Order in court.
Has Sir Henry any questions?
I don't regard the matter as relevant.
Thank you, Doctor.
How much am I paying this fellow? Well, let me see. It's too much.
Professor Hughes? Will you take the oath, Professor?
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Mr. Crisp.
Yes, my lord.
Mr. Davis would like to ask a question.
One moment, Mr.
In case this claim is substantiated, I should like to know whether any effort has been made to trace the descendants of the real Earl?
Yes, sir. They're still living in Condit. In fact, a man whom I claim to be the present holder of the title is here in court. What? His name is Harry Bucket.
Oh, blasphemy.
Harry Bucket.
What's he mean?
He's saying you're a lord.
That's going to cost you a tidy bit. You can't be a lord for nothing.
Take me out. I'm going to faint.
They're claiming that Harry Bucket is Lord Condit. But, Mr. Roberts, you don't follow me.
On the contrary, I have followed you, in spirit, into the Condit Arms, which you'll kindly avoid in future if you wish to remain on the staff of this journal.
But, Mr. Roberts, I was... Hello. He doesn't believe me.
Did you say Harry was an earl?
Well, that's what they're trying to prove.
Let me get you a cup of tea, Mr. Tripp.
The story of a lifetime, and he turns it down. I'll send it straight to the PA. I'll be on the front page of every London paper. I'll be back.
Thank you, Professor. Sir William Carden.
I'll put a stop to this.
It's sheer waste of time, sir, to call more corroboration. I am perfectly willing to admit that the document is genuine, if my learned friend will merely call a witness to prove the signature.
But that's obviously impossible.
For once, Mr. Hayward and I are in complete agreement.
Give him another fiver.
I reckon he's done us this time.
Well, mister, what do you propose to do?
I don't know, sir. This document is 400 years old. It's obvious there can't be a witness.
Is there somebody there?
Yes!
Young woman, control yourself.
Now then, court, sit in.
But I want to give evidence.
Well, you better come in then.
I swear by Almighty God, the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Arthur Duchetti. That's the proper way to pronounce it. Late of Condit Court, commonly known as the Terror of Condit. Yes, that's my father's signature, all right. And his seal. I've seen this before. Everything it says here is true.
3rd Earl, 1564.
Now then, any questions, please, because I'm very pressed for time.
My lord, it's all a little irregular.
Hadn't I... Wasn't it you who came...
Yes, that's right. How are you?
Now you're here, sir, perhaps you'd tell the court. Was it you who enclosed the common?
Yes, and it's weighed very heavily on me. I did make a confession during my lifetime, but my last wife didn't want to give up the land, so she had me walled up. Then she invited the witnesses to dinner, and I regret to say they didn't recover. She's the one lying beside me on the tomb.
Killingham, 2277. Yes, quick. A ghost.
Where?
In court, giving evidence.
What?
There was a ghost in court. A real one.
Let me get you a cup of tea, Mr. Tripp.
Hello, Mr. Roberts. Hold on to your desk, Mr. Roberts. A ghost has just given evidence. The 3rd Earl of Condit, 1564, walked into the witness box and... Yes, ghost, G-H-O-S-T.
You're fired, Mr. Tripp.
For 25 years, I've been reporting kettles straying and bicycles without lights and...
Oh, no. A dark room. Have you got somewhere dark? Cupboard, anything.
Well, Under the stairs?
I've got him. Any London paper would pay the earth for what I've got in here. I'll have him crawling to me, crawling.
What was that?
What was what?
Something went in there.
Gert.
I tell you, something went in.
Oh, let's have a look. There's nothing there.
Oh, Miss Bucket, you're about to become a very privileged woman.
Oh, Mr. Tripp.
You're going to be the first to see a photograph which will appear in every paper in the world. Oh. Now, you ready? All right. No sugar.
Even without the somewhat unconventional evidence of the last witness, we are of opinion that the claim of right has been established. It follows that the land was illegally enclosed, and the people of Condit still retain the right to graze their animals there.
Yeah? Why'd I always say?
Right here.
On the other hand, Mr. Hayward is presumably not the owner of any animal, and he can therefore claim no such right.
The very point I was about to make, my lord.
Lord, I anticipated this point might be raised. At 4 a.m. on the morning in question, I purchased one goose from my co-defendant, Harry Bucket. Or should I say, the Earl Presumptive.
That's you.
My lord, I submit a goose is not an animal within the meaning of the act.
The meaning of what act?
I still rely on three, Elizabeth.
And I on 11, Edward the Confessor.
Gentlemen, for heaven's sake, don't let's start all that again. We find that Mr. Hayward has the right to graze his goose on the old common. The summonses are void, and Mr. Pike must pay the costs.
It's a scandal. There's one law for the rich and another for the aristocracy.
Order in court!
Why, you're quite a stranger, Mr. Bucket.
Whiskey.
Yes, Mr. Bucket. It's like seeing someone from another world.
That's it. Another world. My world ended this morning there in court. Harry Bucket and Earl. What sort of a world's that? And all the old estates being sold up to pay death duties. When I think of the old days, Goodwood Week, while we sat down 40 in the servants' hall alone and me at the head of the table. I was somebody then. I remember Lord Lonsdale saying to me, give me double. Always gave me a cigar, he did, when he said goodbye. Bucket, he said, Goodwood Week wouldn't seem the same without you. Oh, it's not for me to say he was wrong. Ah, the parties we've seen. The orchids, the women. What wonderful jewels they had. And what terrible correspondence. Lavish, why, in the old Earl's time, this one's father, I mean, we were running a stable of 35 hunters down here and 17 chorus girls in town. And now it's all finished. We'll never see the like again. The funny thing is, it isn't his lordship that feels it. When he heard it, he laughed. No, it's me and my sort. All the butlers and valets and footmen who waited on him and looked after him, bowed and scraped and belauded him. We're the ones. No one will have any use for us. Harry Bucket. Well, it's finished me. I can't go on. And when I think of him sitting in Condit Court, drinking tea out of a Dresden saucer, I don't want to go on. I want to get out. But I'll go as I've lived. Respectable. I've put by enough for a decent bit of granite. Before I go, I'll see Tom. Tell him what to put on it. Something tasty and dignified. Here lies Alfred Bucket, butler and valet for 5 and 50. No, I've got it. To the memory of Alfred Bucket, the last of the gentlemen's gentlemen. Good day.
Oh, Mr. Bucket, you've forgotten to...
Oh, Bucket. Don't take it to heart. When this war is over, I don't suppose it'll matter very much how our names are pronounced. And personally, I think it's just as well.
It's a great blow to me, my lord. I've been in your service for 42 years. I've even been paid for 37 of them.
Does this mean you're leaving me, Bucket?
No, my lord. I'm too old to make a change. I shall remain in your service.
Even in a cottage?
At least, my lord, it'd be warmer. But it's all very regrettable.
Stop.
My sister-in-law seems to be recovering.
Very regrettable.
I rather agree.
Paint it again.
I'm perfectly all right. Or am I? Charles, tell me at once, who am I or what am I?
Well, my dear Harriet, for the moment, you're one of the old bouquets. But it rather looks as if very shortly you'll be just an old bucket.
Well, Harry, I reckon they're going to make you lord. What are you going to do about it?
I'm going to have another pint.
Take that. Mum wants to know if she's going to be a lady.
Well, I can't say for sure. But if they pass this special act of Parliament, it seems she'll be a lady and all you kids will be little honorables.
What's that mean?
Well, it means you'll all be little ladies and gentlemen. And you be well behave yourself, see? Darned if I know how a gentleman does behave.
Gan, why don't you go to the pictures?
Darned young varmint. That'll be all, ladies and gentlemen. And as you pass out this way, you may like to have a look at the beech tree where King Charles hid himself after the Battle of Waterloo. I thank you. You'll see a little table on the right as you go out. Well, how am I doing, my lord?
Very well indeed, my lord. But just between ourselves, it was Worcester, not Waterloo. And it was an oak, not a beech.
Oh, they don't know the difference, my lord.
Well, you know, you mustn't call me my lord, my lord.
Can't help it, my lord. After all this time, somehow it wouldn't seem right not to. Would you care to have a look outside?
Oh, I'd like to, yes.
Well, we began to smarten up the old place a bit, eh?
I'd hardly have known it. Thank you, Harry. Very nice.
Good day, my lord.
Good day, my lord.
Oh, the old place begins to look like something, doesn't it?
Yes, it certainly does.
You know, he's right. It does begin to look like something. But what?
Are you coming home to tea?
No, you two go along. I have a little bit of business to attend to first.
Very mysterious.
Harry doesn't seem quite at home with the title yet, does he?
I can sympathize with him. You don't know what it means to have got rid of it.
Yes, I'm afraid you haven't exactly got rid of it.
Don't be silly, darling. You know the Act of Parliament settled that.
Yes, I don't mean that one.
What are you trying to tell me?
Only that my father's 82, and a baronet.
That's a nice thing to tell me now.
Well, I thought you'd rather know the truth.
Do you always tell the truth?
Mary, you forget. I'm a lawyer. Besides, you love me.
I hate you.
Say that again.
Hate you.